Saturn has intrigued human beings ever since they noticed that it belongs to the group of objects called planets, which move relative to the fixed stars in the sky. Saturn is the slowest moving of the ancient planets. It takes fully 29.46 years to return to the same position in the sky. Two orbits of Saturn are thus remarkably close to an integral number of 59 Earth years, so that the phenomena of Saturn repeat on roughly the same yearly date after an interval of 59 years. This was recognized by the ancient Sumerians and Greeks. Thus, Saturn was associated with the measurement of time being named Chronos, time, in Greek legend, and serving as the father of the lord of planets Jupiter, Zeus. The Romans celebrated the winter feast Saturnalia in his honor, and the name Saturn, today, is fixed in our language in the word Saturday. While all of the major planets have faint ring systems, the rings of Saturn are so bright and extensive that Saturn is undoubtedly the most spectacular telescopic object in the sky. When viewed with a good telescope, Saturn seems to float mysteriously and serenely in the vast reaches of space. When the rings of Saturn are open to their maximum, they provide 1.3 times as much light as the ball of the planet. During ring plane crossings, when the rings are edge-on to an observer on Earth and thus become invisible, the visual brightness of the Saturn system diminishes by 0.92 magnitudes. Viewing Saturn with his primitive telescope, Galileo, in 1610, was the first to notice that Saturn was odd. He thought that Saturn was composed of three. "I have observed the most distant planet to be a triple one," he wrote. Other observers thought Saturn had handles, or ansae, a name that is still applied today to the ring systems of Saturn, east or west ansae. It was not until 45 years later, in 1655, that the versatile Dutch scientist Christian Huygens solved the problem of Saturn's rings. Huygens also discovered Saturn's largest and brightest satellite, Titan, a satellite so intriguing that we devote a whole section to it. Incidentally, Huygens felt that the solar system was now complete, and no more objects could be discovered, because with six planets and six satellites known, a perfect number of 12 had been attained. These metaphysical arguments were soon dispelled by the discovery of four more satellites of Saturn by the Italian-French astronomer Jean-Dominique Cassini. Lepidus in 1671, Rhea in 1672, and Dione and Tethys, both in 1684. In 1675, Cassini also discovered the prominent division between the A and B rings, called the Cassini division. For the next 250 years or so, until the end of the 19th century, visual telescopic observation was the tool of the astronomer. Progress was slow, but steady, and work was conducted on such subjects as the dynamics of the solar system and the best parameters for Saturn's orbits, the orbits of its satellites, the dimensions and changing aspects of its rings, the mass and size of Saturn, its shape or its oblateness, its density, and the search for features such as belts or zones in Saturn's atmosphere, or transient spots, which allowed determine of Saturn's rotation rate. Most of the well-known astronomers of that period contributed to our understanding of Saturn: William Herschel, Frederick Bessel, William Bond, Johann Encke, Wilhelm Struve, William Lassell, Edward Barnard, etc. Our understanding of the Saturn system accelerated considerably at the beginning of the 20th century as the new era of science and technology developed. Some of the technological advances that made this possible were the invention of the photographic process, the development of spectroscopy, electronic photometry, high-speed computers, and modern electronics that use large-area, high-quantum efficiency detectors such as CCDs, charged couple devices. Advances in technology culminated in humanity's age-old dream of actually visiting the planets using spacecraft. The Pioneer spacecraft, as its name implies, was used as a pathfinder to test the space between Earth and the major planets and to investigate the environment around Saturn. This was followed by the much more complex and sophisticated spacecraft Voyager 1 and 2, which visited both Jupiter and Saturn, and went on to explore the Uranus and Neptune systems. The Voyager spacecraft helped tremendously in our understanding of Saturn, and sent back hundreds of close-up pictures that were essentially unimaginable to scientists and philosophers, even a mere 100 years ago. To put this achievement into proper perspective, one must imagine what Galileo or Huygens would have exclaimed had they been presented with the beautiful close-up spacecraft images of Saturn's globe, its rings, and satellites. A newer, and even more sophisticated spacecraft called Cassini-Huygens is now on its way to provide us with even more information on Saturn. This is a joint venture between the U.S. National Aeronautics Space Agency, NASA, and the European Space Agency, ESA. NASA is in charge of the Saturn orbiter Cassini, and ESA is responsible for the Huygens descent probe to Titan's surface. Titan has been revealed as a close analogy to primitive Earth, when life was just developing, and therefore it was targeted to be investigated, even more intensely than its large parent Saturn. Every person who has ever looked at Saturn through a telescope is fascinated by this mysterious object and intuitively wishes to study to know more about this strange, faraway object. The description of this strange world given by Sir William Herschel in 1805 cannot be improved upon. There is not, perhaps, another object in the heavens that presents us with such a variety of extraordinary phenomena as the planet Saturn, a magnificent globe, encompassed by stupendous double ring, attended by 7 satellites, ornamented with equatorial belts, compressed at the poles, turning upon its axis, mutually eclipsing its ring and satellites, and eclipsed by them, the most distant of the rings also turning upon its axis, and the same taking place with the farthest of the satellites. All the parts of the system of Saturn occasionally reflected light to each other, the rings and moons illuminating the nights of the Saturnian, the globe and the satellites enlightening the dark parts of the rings, and the planet and rings throwing back the sun's beams upon the moons, when they are deprived of them at the time of their conjunctions. Once, Saturn was revealed in the telescope as its own world, like our Earth. It took a while to arrive at a reasonable physical model of the planet. Until about the mid-19th century, astronomers subscribed to the opinion that Saturn could be inhabited by a race called Saturnians. It was deemed incredible that so splendid a world as Saturn should be devoid of inhabitants. However, misgivings were also voiced, and it was noted that the physical conditions on Saturn might not make the planet suitable for inhabitants of Earth. It was realized, after some time, that the density of Saturn and the other major planets was considerably lower than that of Earth. The notion that Saturn might be composed of material different from Earth was at first rejected, and its low density was explained by assuming that it is a hot, distended, gaseous globe that had not yet cooled down and solidified. Physically realistic models of the overall or bulk composition of Saturn and of its interior structure were first proposed in the 1920s and 30s and were improved and revised from 1950 to 1989. These models were aided considerably by advances in theoretical physics such as atomic and molecular theory and quantum mechanics, and by improved laboratory data and accumulating observational constraints. The first models consisted of a solid interior overlain by a relatively thin atmosphere, comprising about 20% of the planet's radius. To match the density of Saturn, it was supposed that the interior was made up of a thick layer of low-density ice that covered a small rocky core. The atmosphere was cold, and it was presumed to contain gases such as hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, helium, and perhaps methane, whose freezing points are much lower than that of water. At the same time, it was recognized from the study of the abundance of the elements in the solar system and stars that hydrogen was by far the most abundant element. Its high abundance and low density could possibly explain the bulk composition of the giant planets. These early models overlooked two facts. The immense pressure in the interior of Saturn will increase the densities of even the lightest elements such as hydrogen, well above 1.0. Second, the insulating effect of Saturn's deep atmospheric blanket retains most of the primordial energy accumulated during accretion of the planet's mass. The interior of Saturn must therefore be quite hot. In fact, it is now known that Saturn exhibits heat flux from the interior equal to about 80% of the thermal energy it gathers from the Sun. To obtain the best models of the interior of Saturn, the behavior of the elements and molecules, in particular hydrogen and helium, under the high pressures and temperatures in the interior of Saturn must be known. The pressures encountered exceed those that can be simulated in laboratory experiments, so that recourse must be taken to theoretical quantum mechanical calculations. This has led to the interesting insight that when hydrogen is put under great pressure of the order of 3 times 106 atmospheres, 3 mbar, atoms or molecules lose their individuality and a high-density fluid of protons and electrons results. This state is quite conductive and has been given the label metallic hydrogen. There is no agreement on a unique model of Saturn's interior, but there is general consensus on its basic features. The temperature at the 1 atmosphere, 1 bar, level is about 140 K. Proceeding to the interior, the pressures and temperatures of Saturn's atmosphere keep rising, almost like diving into a limitless ocean, until the transition to metallic hydrogen occurs about halfway into the planet at a pressure of about 3 mbar. 3 times 106 atmospheres. After the layer of metallic hydrogen gas, one possibly encounters a mantle of higher density ices, probably liquid, and a core of even higher density rock-forming elements, Si, Mg, O, and Fe. It is not certain whether the core is solid or liquid. A concentration of mass near the core is required by the higher order of terms of Saturn's measured gravitational field. The mantle and core must contain about 20% of Saturn's mass. This makes the fraction of the elements that constitute the core and mantle considerably larger for the solar composition, for which it would be 2-3% of Saturn's mass. Thus, it is generally believed that Saturn's composition is not solar, but is enhanced in rock-forming elements and/or ices by about a factor of 10. This enhancement must be accounted for in scenarios of Saturn's formation from the solar nebula. Most of the direct compositional information that we have about Saturn comes from spectroscopy. Interestingly, Saturn had been observed visually with a spectroscope already in 1863 by the Italian astronomer Father Secchi. He found dark, unidentifiable absorption bands in the red part of the spectrum of the major planets. He felt that the atmospheres of these planets had not yet been cleansed and contained elements different from the Earth's atmosphere. These absorption bands were photographed in 1905 by E.C. Slipher of Lowell Observatory, but an identification was not made until 1932. They are caused by large amounts of gaseous methane in the atmosphere. The detection of molecular hydrogen, H2, although strongly believed present in even larger amounts, proved even more difficult. H2 does not have a regular dipole spectrum in the infrared like most molecules, but exhibits only an exceedingly weak quadrupole spectrum. Lines from this spectrum were finally identified in 1963, and it was found that the amount of H2 above the visible cloud tops of Saturn's atmosphere is about 10 times the amount of the total Earth's atmosphere. Further work, in the 1970s and 1980s, resulted in additional ground-based spectroscopic detection of the species PH3, C2H2, C2H6, and NH3. The major component is H2, comprising about 92% of the atmosphere. Helium makes up most of the rest, but the exact fraction of He is difficult to determine. Its abundance cannot be measured by direct spectroscopic methods, but must be inferred by its effect on other gases. It is estimated that the He abundance by a number of molecules, HeH2, is about 6-10%. This number is quite uncertain, however, and needs further investigation and confirmation. If correct, it makes helium about half as abundant as the 13% measured for the Sun. It might be thought that the abundance of molecules is easier to determine for the extensive atmosphere of Saturn than for the modest atmosphere of its companion, Titan, but this is not the case. The level of the atmosphere probed depends on the wavelength of light. This makes it difficult to calculate the mixing ratios of gases detected in different spectral regions. In the deep atmosphere of Saturn, the most abundant molecule, after He, is thought to be water. But it has not been found because it is frozen out below altitudes to which spectroscopically detectable light reaches. Ammonia also freezes out but higher in the atmosphere, and so it has been observed. Its ratio varies with altitude, and the exact level at which its presence has been detected is not certain. The abundance of methane is affected by the scattering properties of Saturn's atmosphere, and is thus also not easily defined precisely. This lends observed compositional support to models of the interior of Saturn, which point to a substantial enhancement of ice and rock-forming elements. The variety and complexity of the molecules detected in Saturn cannot rival those of the atmosphere of Titan. The same Voyager infrared instrument that detected so many molecules in Titan could confirm only ethane, C2H6, and acetylene, C2H4, for Saturn. The reason for this lies in the number of permissible photochemical reactions, which are considerably more limited under conditions of high H2 abundance. Early 18th and 19th century telescopic observers of Saturn focused much of their attention on the visual appearance of the planet. Investigators looked for the banded structure that is so prominent on Jupiter and tried to discover atmospheric features from which Saturn's rotation period could be determined. Yet, Saturn's cloud structure is considerably different from that of Jupiter. While it shows some bands and zones, this structure on Saturn is very much muted and hard to see. A faint, slightly darker and yellowish band called the equatorial belt at latitudes of about 151 north or south can be seen and was described by many observers. It marks the limit of the bright equatorial zone. Sometimes, another dark band, or possibly two, is seen at higher latitudes of about 301. The polar regions are darker. The variable appearance of these features has been followed by observers from Cassini to Herschel, to the modern Voyager spacecraft images. Saturn is not round, but it exhibits considerable oblateness, the largest of any planet in our solar system. The equatorial radius is about 10% larger than the polar radius. This is caused by Saturn's rapid rotation. The centrifugal acceleration at the equator is 176 centimeters second, 2, which is roughly 17% of its gravitational attraction. The resulting attractive force at the equator is thus considerably less than at the poles, allowing the material at the equator to spread to a much larger radius. One would very much like to have an explanation for the different colors of the zones and belts that have been admired by observers during the last few hundred years. Yet this has been achieved neither for Jupiter nor for Saturn. The subdued tones, it is believed, are caused by coloring agents or chromophores that are present in such minute amounts that they have not yet been identified. The suggestion has been made that the colors are caused by dilute allotropes of sulfur or phosphorus, which can have a yellow or red or even black appearance. The atmosphere above the thick cloud deck is not clear, but contains a haze of NH3 crystals extending to the tropopause. This region contains different dilute concentrations of chromophores that create the different colors among the belts and the zones. It is known that the zones are regions of atmospheric upwelling, while the duskier belts are regions where cold stratospheric air descends. The colder troposphere of Saturn, compared to that of Jupiter, probably results in a paucity of upwelling chromophore parent molecules, such as pH3, leading to a lower concentration of coloring agents and a subdued contrast between the belt zones. The determination of Saturn's rotation rate by using visible atmospheric features was quite difficult, compared to Jupiter, because well-defined features in Saturn's atmosphere are rare. William Herschel, in 1794, was the first to measure a rotation rate, and his value of 10 hours 16 minutes is close to the present value of 10 hours 14 minutes for features near the equator. After Herschel, well-defined spots on Saturn were not observed until 1876, and this was followed by a series of spots observed from 1891 to 1903. It was realized that Saturn has a very pronounced differential rotation rate. Spots traverse Saturn considerably more slowly in a time of about 10 hours 38 minutes. The most accurate rotation rate today comes from measurements of the rotation of Saturn's magnetic field, which is 10 hours 40 and a half minutes. It is felt that this represents the rotation period deep inside Saturn's conductive metallic hydrogen mantle. The rotation rate of surface spots can be used to measure the upper atmospheric currents or the weather on Saturn. It is found that the wind speeds on Saturn's upper equatorial zone are about 500 meters per second, which is 1,100 miles per hour. The same phenomenon is found on Jupiter, but that planet's equatorial wind speed is about 120 meters per second, while jet streams on Earth have typical speeds of perhaps 100 miles an hour. Besides having an equatorial wind speed four times higher, Saturn's equatorial zone is also about twice the width of Jupiter's. It is not yet clear what causes the large difference between the planets. It could be attributed to a combination of Saturn's lower surface gravity and its lower internal heat flux. Another interesting question, not presently answered, is the depth of the zones of differential rotation. It is conjectured that they may persist to 10,000 kilometers or more into the interior of the planet. The weather pattern on Saturn may thus be in an entirely different nature from that observed on Earth. Galileo was the first to describe the Saturn system, but he was confused by its appearance and could not come up with a correct explanation. The correct interpretation for the rings of Saturn and their changing appearance was first given by Christian Huygens in 1655. His discovery of Saturn's satellite, Titan, and its 16-day orbit around Saturn helped him realize that the line of ANSI, i.e., the ring plane, was tilted about 271 with respect to Saturn's orbital plane. With the ring plane fixed in space, to a viewer on Earth, the rings would change from perfectly edge-on to completely open as Saturn travels around its orbit. This resolved Galileo's mystery when 2 years after he viewed the rings, they mysteriously disappeared, leaving him baffled and confounded. When viewed through the telescope, the rings appear to the eye as a solid sheet separated by the Cassini division. Early investigators thus believed the rings to be made of two solid annuli. But how were these annuli held in place around Saturn, and did they have a rotational period? Their uniform appearance foiled every realistic attempt to determine a rotational period. The French mathematician Laplace presented calculations in 1785 which showed that the rings must be made of many individual narrow rings and that the rings must rotate about the planet in Keplerian orbits. That is, each narrow ring must circle the planet with a rotation period given by Kepler's third law. This theory was expanded in 1857 by James Clerk Maxwell, who showed that the rings must be made of individual particles or satellites. These objects are so densely packed that to the eye, they give the appearance of a solid, continuous sheet. The fact that the rings rotate at their respective Keplerian velocities was proven in 1895 by the American astronomer James E. Keeler, using the new science of spectroscopy. As the ring particles rotate about Saturn, those on one side are coming toward us, whereas those on the other side are moving away from us. By the Doppler principle, this produces a wavelength shift to the blue and to the red, respectively. The velocities of the particles on the outside edge of the ring are slower than those on the inside edge, resulting in tilted spectral lines. This Doppler shift tilt was large enough that it could be captured on the photographic plates of that time, giving observational proof of the rotations of the rings and their composition of individual particles. The reason for the somewhat confusing sequences of names is historical. The two bright rings that can most easily be seen in the telescope are called A and B, starting with the ring farthest from Saturn. The A and B rings are separated by the Cassini division, discovered by the Italian-French astronomer Jean-Dominique Cassini in 1675. A fainter ring, called the C ring, or creep ring, was first described by the American astronomer W.C. Bond, 1850. Inside the C ring, astronomers using ground-based telescopes thought they saw another faint ring called D. This ring could not be detected by the Pioneer 11 spacecraft. However, the Voyager spacecraft did find an exceedingly faint ring system near that position. Even though the ring was so faint that it could not have been detected from the ground, its assignment as D ring was kept. A faint diffuse ring outside of the A ring was discerned using ground-based telescopes in 1967 and was called the E ring. It was verified by the Voyager spacecraft, the detection of a very narrow ring 50 kilometers wide outside the A ring, which was called the F ring, was one of the interesting discoveries by the Pioneer 11 spacecraft. The Voyager spacecraft also imaged a very diffuse ring between the F and E ring, which was labeled G. It was first detected indirectly by the Pioneer 11 spacecraft because of its influence on charged particles. The illusory telescopic view of the rings as a solid sheet has already been discussed. During the centuries, many different divisions were spotted and described by observers, but except for the obvious Cassini division and the fleeting NK gap, no consensus by any observers could be established. Not many people, however, were prepared for the astonishing images sent back by Voyager, which showed thousands of individual ringlets. Voyager's best resolution of about 10 kilometers could not reveal the wealth of detail present. A stellar occultation with the Voyager photopolarimeter instrument indicated that there must be tens of thousands of ringlets. Additionally, quite unsuspected anomalous features such as several non-circular ringlets that have notable eccentricities and several braided ringlets were observed. A very puzzling transient phenomenon of radial spokes in the B ring was observed by Voyager. The spokes generally rotate around Saturn with the Keplerian velocities of the particles, and thus lent themselves to several Voyager imaging time sequences that were assembled into a captivating movie. Most likely, the spokes are made of micron-sized particles slightly above the plane of the rings, whose light-scattering properties make them visible, and their formation is connected with Saturn's magnetic field. Despite the exceptionally larger planet extent of the rings, about 61,700 kilometers for the A, B, and C rings, the rings are quite thin. Ground-based observations during Saturn's ring plane crossing yielded an upper limit of about 2 kilometers. Voyager could not measure the exact thickness but determined an improved upper limit of 100 to 200 miles. To get a feeling for the extreme thinness of the ring, one should realize that this is equivalent to an annular sheet of paper that has an outer radius of 400 feet and an inner radius of 220 feet. The rings of Saturn are therefore considerably less than paper thin.
The features of the rings that we would like to know about are the thickness of the rings, the cause for the ring divisions, the compositions of the rings, the particle size distribution of the rings, and the total amount of material in the rings. A remarkably interesting additional phenomenon found by Voyager spacecraft was the dynamic nature of the rings. Sequences of images showed that the ringlet structure is not fixed, but appears to change from orbit to orbit. These small rearrangements, like waves on an ocean, occur even though the ring system as a whole is stable for millions and probably billions of years.
There is no complete explanation for the ordering and arrangement of the ringlets. Density waves appear to account for many features, particularly in the A ring. Gravitational interactions with Saturn's satellites, called resonances, account for more of the features seen. However, the resonances do not offer a ready explanation for many of the prominent major gaps, even the Cassini division. The mystery of the presence of the NK gap was solved in 1991 by going back through the Large Voyager data archive and discovering Saturn's 18th satellite, Pan, in this gap. Perhaps many of the other minor ring divisions are kept clear by smaller yet still substantially sized objects several kilometers in diameter. The narrow F ring has a straightforward explanation. Voyager found two satellites, one on the inner side of the F ring, S16, and one on the outer side of the F ring, S15. Like sheepdogs herding a flock of sheep, these two satellites keep the material from spreading, and therefore they are called shepherding satellites. Despite the sophistication of the Voyager spacecraft and its close approach to Saturn, its instruments could not determine the compositions of Saturn's rings. This was first done in 1970 from ground-based infrared spectra. It was found that the particles in Saturn's rings were predominantly water ice. It is believed that some of the ice may have a core of silicate dust or that pure silicate dust particles are also present. This is particularly so for the C ring, which is considerably darker than the A or B ring. The temperature of Saturn's rings, as measured by their infrared emission, is around 90 K, which is cold enough that no significant amount of water molecules evaporates during a span of a billion years. The size of the particles in Saturn's rings must clearly be less than the upper bound of its thickness. The size range of the particles is estimated from the scattering properties of the rings at wavelengths from the visible to the microwave region. Particularly helpful were radio occultations by the rings of the 3.6 centimeter X-band and 13 centimeter S-band radio transmitters on Voyager. Combining these data leads to the conclusion that the particle sizes range from micron-sized grains to meter-sized boulders, and the upper limit is of the order of 10 meters in diameter. Presently, 30 satellites that circle Saturn are known. This gives Saturn the largest number of satellites in our solar system. Following Huygens' discovery of the Titan in 1655, four more satellites were soon found by Cassini: Lapidus, 1671, Rhea, 1672, and Dion and Tethys, 1684. Since that time, the number of Saturn satellites has steadily increased. By 1900, nine satellites were known, S1 through S9, and these are often called the nine classical satellites of Saturn. Preparations for the Voyager spacecraft spurred renewed interest in searching for Saturn companions, so that during the two-ring plane crossing periods, 1966 and 1980, five more satellites, S10, S11, S12, S13, and S14, were discovered using Earth-based telescopes. These discoveries were aided considerably by the invention and introduction of large-area silicon array detectors called CCDs, charge-coupled devices. The Voyager spacecraft itself found an additional four satellites, S15, S16, S17, and S18, so that the number of known satellites rose to 18. More recently, astronomers from Cornell University obtained a number of deep CCD images of the surroundings of Saturn and found 12 more satellites that have been given the temporary designation S2000, S1 to S2000, S12, for the year of their first observation, 2000. As an aside, we note that this is much greater than the number of 6 to 8 satellites, which Kepler, 1571 to 1630, conjectured would be found around Saturn. It is unlikely that any sizable satellite of the order of hundreds kilometers diameter remains undiscovered, but it is quite likely that there are more 10-kilometer-sized objects. As for the names of the satellites, we note that it was John Herschel, the son of Sir William Herschel, the discoverer of Uranus, who bestowed the present names on the Saturnian satellites. Following the Greek legend of Saturn, they are named after Titans or giants, either brother or sister siblings of Saturn. Before Herschel, Titan was generally known as the Huygensian satellite, and Cassini tried to name the four satellites he discovered after his sovereign Louis XIV. The satellites also have numbers S1 through S18, where the S stands for Saturn. The first nine are neatly ordered by increasing distance from Saturn. Thereafter, their sequence follows the order of their discovery to avoid constant renumbering when new ones are found. Astronomers in the 19th century concentrated on understanding the celestial mechanics of the satellite system by getting good positional measurements from which accurate orbital parameters could be derived. They found that the mechanics of Saturn's satellite system was more intricate and complex than might be expected. John Herschel was the first to note that the time of revolution of Mimas is very close to half that of Tethys, and that of Enceladus approximates half that of Dione. Since that time, these so-called commensurabilities, or resonances, have been studied intensely with increasing sophistication by investigators in celestial mechanics. The Voyager spacecraft found that the narrow F ring was restrained from spreading by two shepherding satellites, one on the outside of the ring, Pandora, S15, and one just inside the ring, Prometheus, S16. A small satellite, Atlas, S17, was found just outside the A ring, and, it is believed, keeps this ring from spreading outward, thus accounting for its sharp boundary. Finally, careful inspection of the 30,000 Voyager images of Saturn and its rings in 1991 revealed an additional small satellite, Pan, S18, in the Encke gap. The satellite keeps this gap clear and provides a reason for Encke's gap at this particular location in the rings. Limited to the naked eye, classical telescope observers found it difficult to determine physical properties of the satellites, because even with reasonably sized telescopes, the satellites appeared as mere faint points of light. It was realized, since it was discovered by Cassini, that Iapetus is much brighter on the western side of Saturn, its trailing side as it orbits Saturn, compared to the eastern side. As Cassini stated, this satellite disappears regularly for about one half of its revolution when it is to the east of Saturn. Modern photoelectric measurements have determined that this variation is 1.7 magnitudes, or a factor of 4.8. This light curve, invariable for centuries, is considered proof that Iapetus keeps the same face toward Saturn as it orbits that planet, just as our moon shows the same face to Earth. Iapetus's rotational period is synchronously locked with its rotational period around Saturn. Variations in visual orbital brightness were sought for the other satellites but yielded conflicting results. In the 1970s, ground-based electronic photometry revealed that the satellites Rhea, Dione, and Tethys differ from Iapetus and are all brighter on the leading side, respectively, by 0.20, 0.40, and 0.20 magnitudes. On the other hand, Mimas is brighter on the trailing side by about 0.2 magnitudes. Most of Saturn's satellites for which rotation periods have been determined, namely S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, S8, S10, and S11, are synchronously locked to Saturn. The rotation period of the outermost satellite, Phoebe, is 9.4 hours, and Hyperion does not have a stable rotation period, but tumbles chaotically. Attempts were made to determine satellite sizes during periods of superior seeing, and sizes were estimated from their brightness by assuming a reasonable reflectivity. The theory of orbital resonance, discussed earlier, allowed determining the masses of some satellites. Combining the mass and size made estimates of the satellite's densities possible. This led to the interesting realization in the 1920s that satellite densities were probably best described by a value fairly close to one which is similar to the density of water ice. This density is considerably different from that of rocky material, whose values are 2.5 to 3.0. The icy composition of Saturn's satellites has been borne out by modern measurements. Electronic photometry in the 20th century was used to determine accurate values for the brightness, or visual magnitude, of the satellites, as well as their broadband colors in the violet, blue, visible, and red. These measurements show that the surface reflectivity, or albedo, of the satellites was quite high, typically of the order of 50 to 60%. The highest value measured was 90% for Enceladus. A material on Earth that has this high reflectivity would be brilliantly and blindingly white. Improved measurements in the thermal emission regime showed that the surface temperatures were quite low, of the order of 90K, even in the warmest regions near the equator. Probably the most significant ground-based results were provided by infrared spectroscopy of Iapetus, Rhea, Dione, and Tethys in 1976. These data unmistakably showed the unique signature of water ice. Combining this direct proof of the existence of water ice with the low density of the satellites and their low surface temperatures leads to the conclusion that the large spherical satellites of Saturn are composed of water ice. They are thus labeled Saturn's icy satellites. To make further progress in our understanding of the satellites, close-up views were needed, and these became available at the beginning of the space age. Following the exploratory pioneer missions of the two Voyager spacecraft imaged all 14 satellites known at the time, plus four additional ones that were discovered. Having roughly the same density and being of comparable size, it might be expected that the satellites all had a similar origin, and thus closely similar appearances, but this was not found to be the case. Each satellite turned out to have its unique individual characteristics, making them distinctly different from each other. Mimas is the innermost satellite of the large icy satellites and is quite heavily cratered, and its surface shows little evidence of interior activity. Its appearance is dominated by one large crater, Herschel, on its leading surface. The crater is 130 kilometers in diameter and thus covers about one-third of the satellite's diameter. Enceladus. This satellite is almost the same size as Mimas, but it has considerably different surface features. There are sizable areas on this satellite that are moderately cratered, though not as densely as Mimas. Its most noteworthy features are large uncratered smooth plains. These plains are traversed by very noticeable ridges and grooves. It appears that large areas of this satellite were flooded by liquid water from the interior, which formed the smooth plains and obliterated any previous cratering history. The extensive icy plains of this satellite give it exceedingly high reflectivity. It is not yet clear what made this satellite so different in appearance and geological history from its twin, Mimas. Tethys. This satellite is densely cratered across its whole surface, similar to Mimas. It presents almost no evidence of geological surface activity. Interestingly enough, similar to Mimas, Tethys has one very large 400 kilometer diameter impact crater, Odysseus. Although the extent of this crater is 40% of the satellite's diameter, it does not dominate the surface as Herschel does for Mimas, because Odysseus has lost its sharp boundaries and deep interior and has relaxed considerably. An additional feature of Tethys is a 2,000 kilometer long valley called Ihaka Kosma that stretches 3/4 of the way around its circumference. Dione has the highest density of any of the icy satellites, and thus probably the highest component of rocky material. This is corroborated by its relatively low albedo and the weaker signature of water ice on its surface. Its overall crater density is relatively low, and there is no significant difference in crater density between the leading and trailing sides. There is, however, a distinct difference in visual appearance between these two sides. The trailing hemisphere is darker by 0.4 magnitudes, a factor of 1.5, and shows strong albedo markings of global dark terrain traversed by half a dozen broad white bands, some extending across the whole diameter. These white bands have a reflectivity of 0.7 versus the general background reflectivity of the dark material of 0.2. It is likely that the bright bands were created by a global system of faults that allowed fresh clear ice to cover the surface. Dione has several terrains that have different crater densities and a considerable level of geologic activity and resurfacing. Rhea. Rhea is the largest of the icy satellites. Similar to Dione, it has a trailing hemisphere that is darker, though only by 0.2 magnitudes, a factor of 1.2. And like Dione, it has several bright bands extending across the otherwise darker trailing hemisphere. Rhea is fairly heavily cratered, and there appears to be no difference in cratering activity between the leading and trailing side. There are indications that it is an older terrain that retained craters larger than 30 kilometers in diameter, and a younger resurfaced terrain, but there is no consensus on this point. Iapetus. The huge albedo difference between Iapetus' leading and trailing sides has already been mentioned. The leading side has a reflectivity of 4%, as dark as coal dust, whereas the leading side is quite bright and has a reflectivity of 30 to 40%. It might be thought that a few good images of the satellite would have resolved this question, but this was not the case. The Voyager spacecraft did not get close enough to Iapetus for good high-resolution pictures, and the dark areas were so dark that the cameras could not pick up any detail. The bright side of Iapetus is quite heavily cratered, because its density is 1.1. Iapetus clearly must be composed of water ice, thus the reason for the bright and dark hemispheres of Iapetus still remains a mystery. The two other moderate-sized satellites, Hyperion and Phoebe, are quite different from each other. Spectroscopy indicates that Hyperion belongs to the class of icy satellites. Its size of 300 kilometers argues for a spherical shape, yet it is quite irregular and probably is a leftover fragment of a past collision. Phoebe, on the other hand, although slightly smaller, appears to be spherical. It is in a retrograde orbit that makes it an irregular satellite, and it has a dark surface and a visual reflectivity that is better matched by rocks. The largest moon of Saturn, Titan, has turned out to be one of the most interesting satellites in the solar system. With a diameter of 5,150 kilometers, it is one of the largest solid objects in the solar system, only slightly smaller than Ganymede of Jupiter, but considerably bigger than the planet Mercury, and easily dwarfs our most distant member, Pluto. When Titan was discovered by Huygens in 1655, no one could have foreseen that it held so many surprises. For centuries, people thought it as just another moon whose position, orbit, brightness, transits across Saturn, etc., needed to be duly observed and recorded. It was not until modern instrumentation was employed that Titan revealed its unusual nature. Using infrared spectroscopy, G.P. Cooper, in 1943, detected deep methane absorptions, similar in strength to those of other major planets. This was quite astonishing for a satellite. Further observations, in the 1970s, of stronger methane bands farther in the infrared, combined with careful laboratory comparison spectra, led to the conclusion that the amount of methane on Titan was of the order of 20% of the total Earth's atmosphere, a very substantial atmosphere 20 times larger than the atmosphere on Mars. More advances in infrared instrumentation in the 10 to 20 millimeter region revealed the presence of ethane, C2H6, ethylene, C2H4, and acetylene, C2H2. Ultraviolet data showed that the atmosphere of Titan must be quite hazy and filled with aerosols, small smog-like particles, that scatter the incoming radiation. There were suggestions that Titan's atmosphere might be more substantial, requiring the additional presence of spectroscopically non-detectable gases such as N2, NE, and AR. From the limited amount of ground-based data, it was not possible to separate the effects of scattering from those of a denser atmosphere, and a determination of the correct amount of CH4 in a vertical column of Saturn's atmosphere remains elusive. It was clear, however, that Titan's atmosphere exhibited a most interesting character. The Voyager 1 spacecraft was therefore targeted to pass remarkably close to Titan, within 4,000 kilometers of its cloud tops. The data acquired were both disappointing and fascinating. Despite the excellent resolution of Voyager's cameras, the hazy atmosphere prevented any glimpse of the surface, a surface which many investigators believe could be one of the most unusual and spectacular in our solar system. On the other hand, the atmospheric data returned were exceedingly interesting and fascinating. Three instruments provided the most important data. The ultraviolet spectra showed definite evidence of N2. The radio occultation experiment provided the atmospheric temperature profile and the surface pressure. And the infrared instrument discovered a whole host of new organic molecules, as well as temperature data and information on the atmospheric structure. In fact, one might say that the capabilities of the infrared instruments were as well matched to the investigation of Titan's atmosphere, as might be hoped. The Voyager experiments found that CH4 is indeed a lesser constituent of Titan's atmosphere, estimated at roughly 4% with a possible range of 2 to 10%. Thus, the exact amount of CH4 column abundance, although much better confined, is still not precisely determined. The major constituent of Titan's atmosphere is molecular nitrogen, N2, just as on Earth. The surface pressure on Titan is 1.5 atm, and the surface temperature is 94 K. Although this surface pressure is only slightly greater than that of Earth, the amount of Titan's atmosphere in numbers of molecules is actually 11 times greater. Because of Titan's lower surface gravity, about 7 times less than that of Earth, a greater amount of atmosphere is needed to provide the same surface pressure. The lower surface pressure also makes Titan's atmosphere very much more extended than that of Earth. The reason for Titan's diverse composition can be found in the extraordinary photochemistry of its atmosphere. At high altitudes, methane is disassociated by the energy of solar ultraviolet radiation and forms free radicals such as CH2, CH3, and atomic hydrogen. The very reactive radicals form more complex hydrocarbon molecules such as ethane, C2H6, propane, C3H8, ethylene, C2H4, and acetylene, C2H2. The set of reactions that forms these molecules is rather complex. It includes creating and destroying radicals, vertical and horizontal transport in Titan's atmosphere, and collisions with the abundant constituents of Titan's atmosphere. Because of the relatively low surface gravity of Titan, atomic and molecular hydrogen escape. Thus, these reactions are not reversible, and Titan loses hydrogen steadily at a rate of roughly 5 times 1027 atoms per second. This loss of hydrogen, and its replenishment by photochemical means, results in an equilibrium concentration of 0.2% H2 in Titan's atmosphere. Note that the photochemistry described is unique to Titan. It does not occur on Saturn because that planet has a huge reservoir of H2, which is held tightly by its very much larger gravity field. The molecules produced include nitriles, which are organic molecules that contain nitrogen. Additionally, oxygen-bearing molecules have been observed. The nitriles are formed by disassociation of N2, which has a very strong bond and is hard to break, so that it requires very energetic short-wavelength UV radiation, or electron impact disassociation high in Titan's atmosphere. Chief among the nitriles are hydrogen cyanide, HCN, and cyanogen, C2N2. The oxygen-bearing molecules are believed to come from impacts by comets that contain B50% water and can thus supply oxygen. The photochemistry of Titan has been verified both by theoretical calculations and laboratory simulations. Essentially, all of the molecules observed in Titan's atmosphere have been produced in roughly the proper abundance using laboratory simulation experiments. The net result of Titan's photochemistry is the loss of hydrogen and the production of heavier and more complex hydrogen-deficient organic molecules. As of the year 2000, 13 complex molecules were identified in Titan's atmosphere. Laboratory simulations have produced an additional 20 or so complex hydrocarbon molecules that should be present in sufficient abundance that they should be detectable by some of the instruments of the Cassini spacecraft Higgins probe. There are further important consequences of Titan's photochemistry, which explain the satellite's pervasive haze layer. Complex organic molecules can connect to form long-chain polymers. These polymer chains can apparently grow to complexes containing several hundred molecules and reach a size of the order of 0.1 millimeter radius. These small particles, in turn, form irregular aggregates of 0.4 to 0.5 millimeter radius, and these aggregates form aerosol particles in Titan's atmosphere. Their approximate size has been determined by their light scattering properties from the ultraviolet to the infrared. The present consensus holds that the haze in Titan's atmosphere does not extend to the surface, but that the atmosphere below the tropopause at a height of about 70 kilometers is clear. Calculations further show that it would take 50 years for the 0.5 millimeter smog particles to fall to the surface, so that some mechanism must exist to clear the atmosphere of this haze, very possibly condensation and precipitation of methane rain. Whatever the mechanism, a large amount of organic material, be it aerosol particles or condensable gaseous species such as ethane, must have accumulated for possibly billions of years, and it still accumulates on Titan's surface. What the surface of Titan looks like is therefore a tantalizing and intriguing question. There is speculation about liquid methane lakes or oceans. A continuous source of methane in the atmosphere is required to replenish the methane that is being destroyed by photochemistry, or oceans several hundred meters to kilometers deep that contain a mixture of ethane, methane, and nitrogen, or possibly there is only dry land, and mechanisms that reprocess the organic material on the surface have not presently been considered. Titan is an object in our solar system, which, despite spacecraft visits, still has a large number of extremely interesting unanswered questions. For this reason, the Cassini mission decided to send a special probe called Higgins into Titan's atmosphere, rather than the atmosphere of Saturn. It is hoped that this probe will answer the many questions about Titan's unusual character. One of the big mysteries of our Earth is, of course, how life began. A number of models of early Earth's atmosphere postulate an extensive primordial atmosphere made up of H2, CH4, NH3, N2, etc., similar to the major planets. Through interactions with an intense solar wind, the Earth's hydrogen was soon lost and left behind an atmosphere similar to that on Titan. The process of photochemistry could then produce the same suit of complex organic materials that we see on Titan. Among these molecules, nitriles are the most important, because such molecules as hydrogen cyanide, HCN, cyanogen, C2N2, and cyanoacetylene, HC3N, play a crucial role in forming amino acids, which are believed to be the precursors to simple cell formation. Once life begins, photosynthesis produces oxygen. In a sense, Earth has an atmosphere remarkably similar to that of Titan, in which the main constituent is N2. The major differences lie in the second major constituent, which on Titan is the reducing gas, CH4, whereas on Earth, It is the oxidizing molecule O2. Some of the O2 on Earth is produced by photodissociation of H2O, but the majority comes from plant photosynthesis. This process started after life began on Earth. On Earth, the surface temperature is, of course, much higher than on Titan, allowing reactions that would not occur on this satellite. Perhaps, if the temperature were 50 to 100 degrees higher on Titan, life could form on this satellite also. In any case, the satellite allows us to study the type of chemical reactions and photochemistry that is analogous to the prebiotic processes that were at work on primitive Earth.